Okay. No, thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for joining tonight.
Is that how Joe talks?
What? I talk?
Like Humphrey Bogart?
No, man. What are you talking about?
I don't know. Sometimes I think that you're like an actor, man.
Yeah, I'm acting all right.
Yeah.
Act like I would hurt nobody.
Yeah. Don't hurt me, man.
Not you, man. You the money.
Yeah. So.
Where are you? Can you see?
Here.
No, I just want to go over a couple things with you. I sent out some announcements, and I just want to make sure that couple things. So just a reminder, in February we do have the sales rally. That's going to be pretty much like all of the, it's a big, huge rally with like top banks, like all different types of top originators. It's really inspirational to have people like, Grant Cardone might be there, or sometimes like last year they had Tony Robbins. It's just really cool. There's realtors there. It's about 2,000 people. And everyone gets together and they just talk about, you know, how their year was, their goals. Mark's been to one with me before. There was a colonel there. Colonel
Summit?
Colonel Plum. And he talks about his story and basically like somebody that was locked in captivity in the Philippines for 6 years, and how they turned their whole life around, how they were able to stay tough and strong. And they just go through different inspirational stories and talk about goals in the future of the banking industry. And you get to meet a lot of successful people. So it's a really good thing. That's going to happen in February. It's a 3-night deal and it's all expenses paid. We're going to take probably 2 people with us. And so it's just all based on, if you've earned it or not. And so, and then in March, Grant Cardone is doing a 10X con and he gave me an extra ticket. And so I'm going to bring somebody with me. It's not based on anything but just, performance. Is how I'm going to make the decision who's going to go. And so, but it'll be all expenses paid, flight, hotel, everything. So that's going to be really cool. There's going to be some really badass people there. And so, and the thing is that, it's good to, when you're trying to, grow and expand, it's very good to reach up and network, And so it's really powerful. There's going to be, really big players there. And so it's always good to get around where it's better. And so I want, obviously all of you guys to go. It's limited seating. I think there's only, does anyone know, like maybe 500 seats, or I don't know.
Yeah, I was looking. It was showing that it was like already halfway sold out.
Yeah. So, but those are a couple of things that are happening in February and March. Obviously I'd like everyone to go, but it's very expensive and then there's limited seating, but we'll just see who ends up going, and it's not based off of favoritism or anything like that. So, it's just based off of, who's doing the best and who I think is going to be the shining star for 2017. So, but you won't have to pay for anything. The other thing that, that we are setting up. So some of you guys have been doing Cardone U on my account.
And I'm almost finished.
Yeah. Well, you couldn't be almost finished. So there's probably over 3,000 hours of content. So are you sure?
Yeah.
I don't think you'd be almost finished with it. What you mean, like you're finished with one of the chapters?
I think I'm finished with 2 chapters.
Yeah, probably a couple chapters, but the whole thing is...
The whole thing. I think so. Yeah, last time I checked.
Hmm. There's no way you could do it because there's over 3,000 hours of content on it.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, there's the just the top 100 sales tips is like 1,200 hours. And so, I've just made it through like a couple chapters, But you'd have to be. It's gonna take a few months to get it, and you'd have to be
3,000 hours.
Yeah,
that's a lot. But
yeah, maybe. No, it's not gonna take.
No, no, Mark.
3,000 hours. I mean, that's almost a year and a half's worth of work.
It depends on how much time you put into it. Yeah, but I'm talking about with not just the 3 modules. There's also the handling objections. That's a whole separate module, and then. On top of that, there's the bonus stuff. Inside of that bonus stuff, it's got at least I don't know, 400 or 500 videos in it. I don't know. I mean, because each one of those chapters has its own set of videos.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, I mean, if you're taking in every second, that's a lot. That's a lot of time.
Right? And then, you know.
Well, 10,000 hours is 7 years, man. So, I mean, if you're saying 30,000 hours, yeah, that's a 3, lot. 3, I mean, you said 3,000, yeah, so.
Yeah.
I was working on over the holidays, the car down, getting kicked out.
Hmm? Yeah, because somebody else is like, yeah.
Yeah, so yeah, so what ends up happening is that they're
you didn't want it bad enough.
Yeah, you didn't want it bad enough. Yeah. See,
you kick you out, but if you get back in,
you have to be obsessed, man.
So, part of the training.
Yeah, part of the training, man.
I kept losing my spot where I was already.
Really? Mm-hmm. No. So what's going to end up happening? I think they're going to be done with it this week. From what I was talking with Dave, and basically, you guys are going to get your own logins to it. And you're gonna have access to, you're gonna have a dedicated coach that's gonna check in with you and follow up. We're gonna have meetings and watch how you're progressing through the training.
That's awesome.
And so it's not just some knucklehead that you're gonna be talking to in you know another country. It's actually like one of his sales managers. And let me tell you, man, they are sharp. Okay, and that's kind of what we're gonna be talking about here in a second. You know, the thing is, here's the deal on this, though. I'm not sure if I'm going to release this to people that haven't funded loans yet because it's extremely expensive. This is not cheap. So it's probably going to be beginning, and people are going to get their own license to people that have funded loans. If you haven't funded any loans, then you're going to have to do a shared account because this is very, very expensive for this. And so, and basically, it's all about accountability. You know, they're going to tell me there's data reporting, and they're going to tell me if you're, you know, progressing through the courses or not. You know, but because of the amount of the investment, I need, you know, absolute commitment from anyone that's going to be involved with it. And I can tell you, just for me, spending a few hours on it, probably 10 hours, the content's amazing. But you have to be fully vested in it. You know, it really is very good content, and the content updates as you know they're you know updating their you know for instance their mastermind is once a week, so that anytime the content updates, it automatically feeds into there. And so once you go through the whole thing and you graduate, then you're going to get a certificate. And like I said, whoever graduates from it and gets a certificate, just the bonus I'm offering is an extra $1,000. But you know. But what's going to happen to you is, I think that once you go through it and you truly get the material down and you're working with Dave or Jared or Joe, that you're going to become a master. You're going to become a lethal salesperson, you know. And so just talking with them and dealing with them. But, you know, it's going to require, like, I got a question for you guys. Last week when we met, we talked about you guys studying for at least 30 minutes to an hour a day. Who's committed to that for the past week, every single day?
Studying?
Yeah.
Or listening to audio?
Or training. There's testing and trainings and studying. And who's committed to that?
I mean, I've been doing onboarding, but
that's... Yeah, I know. But, I mean, is anyone else?
Outside of this week,
just in general, or...
No, the last week I asked all you guys, just to give you an example, just to see kind of where you're at. I asked all you guys last week if... You know, every day study for at least 30 minutes a day. Train, do something that's revolving.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. But yeah. You're not speaking of just card on you.
No. Just like right, yeah. That revolving of, oh, yeah. Of selling or closing or rehearsing.
Absolutely.
Or, what have you been doing? Just kind of an example.
Now, I've been getting back into my personal development, man. Just, you know, getting back into reading Think and Grow Rich again. It'll be my third read. And listening to The Magic of Believing with Claude Bristol. It may seem like it's unrelated, but it's 100% related information.
Well, so how it applies to you? You think it applies to you? I mean, it may not apply to us the same, but it's. I mean,
no, that's really good.
There's some videos that I shared with him, and he probably thinks I'm out of my mind, but I mean, it's the way it hit me. So.
Yeah, I mean, if you just think about the title, The Magic of Believing, Claude Bristol is saying there's something magical that happens when you start believing. and believing yourself to be able to do whatever it is that is out there for you to do.
I get healed.
You know, so it's applicable. I think anybody can get something out of it. I mean, I may get something different than what Adrian may get, which may be different than what Jason may get, but I believe everyone gets something out of it that they will not leave that book, that read and in an applied book, without something positive changing in their life. It's just, that's my game. That's my personal stamp on it.
I'm just saying. I can tell you're sincere.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Sincere.
Yeah.
Real.
No, that's good. That's really good. That's good to, you know, anything that can help with the psychological is vital, because that's 80% of what we do is the mental and your state that you're in. And, you know, so that's good. Also, specifically mechanically to what we do, product guideline understanding. If you have a weakness, you know, and you know what Peter Drucker talks about in managing self is evaluating where you're at, you know, and where are your weaknesses, where are your strengths, and bridging those gaps, right? If you know you have a weakness in an area, it's understanding guidelines, then you want to, you know, bridge that gap so you can become better, you know. But that doesn't happen until you do that analysis, you know, you do that examination on yourself and see where am I strong, where am I weak at, you know. And so you really need to do that if you want to get better. So, you know, if you need to study on how to close or overcome objections, or if you're not sure, okay, when you get the customer on the phone and you got the information of what to do next, it's the information is there for you. But you have to go and put effort into go and find it. If you're choking when the customer gives you an objection, says he wants to wait or he needs to talk to his wife, and you don't know how to overcome that, and you miss the sale, then you need to learn how to do it. Angelo can't come and do, you know, do all these things for you all the time. It's there for you. That's why we've invested all this money in doing all these things. But you know, I mean, and that goes to, you know, what. You know, when I purchased this card on you, I purposely made him work very hard to get the sale, just to see how good he was trained, and put him off for probably about 3 weeks. You know, just to see how, if he was, if they really, if they're full of crap over there, or what are they doing? And you know, one of the things that Grant talks about that I think is extremely, it's very true, and I have it up on the board over there, is that if we the customer doesn't stop the sale, we do. Okay? And you have to really, really understand that. I'm not talking about 480 credit score loans. I'm talking about qualified customers. We're responsible for every lost sale. We are responsible for it. And if we don't close them, it's because we didn't uncover something. You know, we didn't build the trust. We didn't deliver. There's something that happened, but it's our fault. If you think that I'm not going to just, he says I'm, you know, I'm going to wait, or I'm not going to push that. I'm not going to close that deal because I want the house more than he does. You're going to lose a lot of business from that. If you think they're just going to come to you motivated and ready, it's not always the case. You will have some that do that, but a lot of your loans are not going to be in that type of situation. You're going to have to do something to them, say something to them, do something to them to get them to do it. Okay? I want to make sure you guys really, really understand. This is a huge, huge thing right here. But you have to know how to talk to people. And everything comes down to your attitude. The first thing is attitude. If you're not in the right mental state, or you're not in the right attitude, then you're not going to be able to get this. Let me just give you an example. How did Dave get me from going from spending $1,500 on a regular ticket to spending 10 grand on a VIP ticket in less than 3 minutes?
He sold you on the benefits. And actually, what you probably actually what you wanted, and sold you on that, and basically indirectly told you this is the price for getting what you want.
So you think about that though, how powerful that is. You know. So he did something though. If you watch how this is how well he's been trained. After he got me to upgrade the account from a regular account to corporate, he did something called the second sale. Because I'm already buying him in that mode. So he grabbed the VIP at the same time. Now I knew what he was doing. I was watching what he was doing, but I just wanted to see how good he was and what he was going to do. So he got me from the personal account to the corporate account. That's a $60,000 sale. Then with that, he got me with a $10,000 VIP. Because I'm already in the mode to buy.
It's only $10,000.
Yeah. Angelo, what's going to happen when you meet Grant? What's going to happen to your life?
It's out of value.
Your life's going to change, man. What's already happened because you've learned from Grant? See, this is the kind of questions he was asking me. So if he would have pushed off and not persisted after the 20th call and said, well, he's not motivated, he's not a buyer. You know, he would have missed out on a lot of company money. He probably made, I don't know how much, $5,000 commission off of that. I don't know. So, but the thing is that, and that's what I want to go back to. On Friday, this guy blew up my phone with 9 calls in a row before the day was over. So while we're over here eating cake and shit, this guy's blowing up my phone, wanting the sale. So, I mean, I'm just telling you the difference. He wasn't letting up. You know, and he's trained, you know, as a killer, man. Yeah, and that's probably why he's a sales manager. And you'll probably be talking to him and dealing with him. You'll see he's good. You know, he's almost as good as me. he's practiced, and he tells me he still trains every day for an hour a day. And you'll probably be dealing with him or some of his other people, and hearing how he talks, seeing what he does, and you know he's probably going to be helping out a lot. But that's going to come with this package, and so I would definitely use his tap into that resource a lot. But the point that I want to try and make to you is, you know, yeah, you're going to get layups and they're great, but some of these people, you've got to influence them. That's what selling is. You're persuading. You're influencing. So I'm just telling you guys right now, if they say I need to wait or I need to put on hold or they're not returning your call and part of it is because, yes, I had the desire for it, but they, you know, in my mind, I was, you know, put in my mind pretending that I didn't want it because I wanted to see how hard he was going to fight for it, you know. And so, you know, and obviously, again, I'm talking about qualified people here. I'm not talking about people that really can't afford to get a loan, or they don't have the money, or they don't have they don't qualify. I'm talking about somebody that, you know, has good credit, they have the income. The ones that are, you know, usually the harder customers to get, you know. And so, so I think that as a group, it's something that we all need to get better at and learning how to persuade and influence people.
Yeah, layups are good. 3 shots are really great as well, but the slam dunks will get one going.
Yeah, I mean it's, you know, you're gonna get people that. You just need to tell them something, and when you tell that, it's like, again, you pick the lock in their brain to get them to go. You know, they just need to be shown it in a different way, and then their mind opens up, and that's the key to a great salesperson is finding out what that is in that person.
Questions.
You know, and that's asking the questions. Exactly. That's asking the questions. You know, and he did that with me. He asked me, okay, how much revenue does the company do? You know, how many people do you have? So he knew I was a qualified buyer. If I said, I don't make any money or we don't have any revenue, he's not going to try and pitch me these products. And so, you see, so he knew when he was, and that goes back to, you know, the script. and knowing that by heart to know to qualify this person if they fit in, you know, into this, if they're a buyer, a qualified buyer, a qualified prospect. Because if they're not, then it doesn't make sense to spend your time on. And that goes back to selecting your customer. And so, you know, use the resources, the realtor flyers, the leads, you know, select your customer, look for, you know, better loans, better credit, people that have money. I would dance with them. I wouldn't mess with stuff that's, you know, people don't have any money, they don't have any credit. I just, you know, if you're new, maybe, you know, when you're training, those are good to practice on. But you, after a while, you don't need to be doing that. You know what I mean? Because here's the thing, let's say you can pick up just one or two deals like that a day that are 200,000, 300,000 plus, you know, just scooping those up every day, you know? I mean, it's out there. You just have to, go for it. The deals are out there, man. So, anyway, those are. I mean, it was good. I mean, when you start to get into this and you have your own seat, and you start to deal with their team, I hope that you're as inspired as I am dealing with them, because they're trained. The people I talked to were. They were trained very well, but know that, yeah, I mean, and this is an awakening for me. I'm not the sales guru, you know, but it helps me to learn it too, you know, that we are responsible for every lost sale, you know, and there's something that we can do to influence them and turn their life around. I mean, that's what leaders do, right? Or, you know, powerful people, you're the people at your church, your pastor. He says something to you and it just changes the way you look at it in an instant. He can say something that just changed your whole life. Maybe one second you're feeling like this, the next second you feel like this. And people like, you know, your church, maybe there's someone that's very influential. He says something and it changes the way you look at something. And that's what it's all about is, and you have to be in the right, you have to have the right attitude though, right? If you're in a negative attitude, then everything's messed up. You know, what comes out of you. So state management is extremely vital to, you know, to your success. You've got to prepare your mind before you come in here every single day. And reading those type of books are great. You know, self-personal development, positive thinking. I know that's a cliche, but that's probably the biggest thing I can tell you, that a positive thinking attitude is more important than selling. It's the most important thing.
You attract whatever it is you are. If you got negative energy in you, and this is just the way I believe it is. It works. You attract that same thing. It comes out of your vocals. It comes out in your tonality. It comes out in your countenance. It comes out, and it, you know, we can either mirror and attract to us what we want, or we can attract that which we don't want. So we got to get rid of whatever it is that we don't want. So I call it putting up a bat signal. I just believe it's true. You put up a bat signal, Spider-Man does not show up, and Batman does. Batman just comes because it's a bat signal. So if that's positivity in me coming out, positivity comes to me. If negativity is in me and it's coming out, it just brings more negative situations to me. And I guess if I'm foolish enough to believe that, I'm foolish enough to change it. Yeah. You know what I mean?
I used to work with a guy in my last bank that I was working at. We used to kind of make fun of him because he had a bunch of animal pictures on his cubicle, and they were like kind of goofy, kind of silly, like kind of cute animals. And, you know, we were poking fun at him, but he gave us the reason why he has them on there. He says, every time before I make a call, I look at the things that make me happy and positive, and then I go on the call, and the people can hear it in my voice.
Yeah, tone is very important. I mean, tone is very, very important when you're talking to somebody. So, you know, what I want to do now is just kind of go over a couple things with, you know, going over objections, because I think that's an area that, you know, we all need to get better on. Especially what I see a lot of, and what I really want to put to bed, is price. This interest rate thing has got to, you know, we really got to work on it as a group. You know, so I keep hearing either something price, and we don't know how to respond to that when someone says they're going to lower rates somewhere else, and it seems like we feel like, and I'm guilty of it too, you know, but we feel like we have to, but I'm not going to back down from it. I think we need to keep searching for ways on how to deal with this, and so
I had an idea. One of my realtors, Stephanie, out there in Kansas, was telling me about our customer with Quicken Loans. Mm-hmm. And she started expressing some stuff to me. And after we got the phone, right before we got the phone, she was just like, Jason, I look forward to doing more business with you, sending more people your way. She said, because I like the idea that at 8:00 at night, you answer your phone. Mm-hmm. And she said, I think that's important for any working client, that usually they work till 5:30, 6:00 in the evening time. And then when they want to call somebody for help, when it's about a home loan, who can they call if you already closed down? And so when you said about the interest rates, it's kind of like, okay, what is it costing you for selling for an interest rate, Angelo?
Yeah. So this is a good point. How you justify higher prices or higher rates? And I'm not saying we're not higher rates. I mean, we don't have high rates here compared to the market. But if it's sometimes we could be, someone could be a quarter under us or a half. That's definitely possible. But great service is the way to higher prices. Okay, that's the way to how you have higher margins is great service. If you look at the top companies in the world, you know, we talk about Steve Wynn and Encore, we talk about,
Lamborghini,
Mercedes, and so you're gonna have to give the customer excellent service in order to justify if it's higher. And we talked about this last week that, you know, if when he had his deal that he was working on last week, and there's been other deals where someone says, "Well, I'm a 0.25% lower than someone else." That's just one component of it. You know, there's also, you know, the servicing side. Is your loan going to be serviced or is it going to be sold? Is the company you work with, is it a bank? Is it a mortgage company? We need to find all these things out. Remember, whoever's the most convincing on that conversation is going to win. Whether they are or you are is going to determine if you close that deal. But one thing I can tell you, that the moment that you quit, the deal's dead. The deal's dead the moment you quit. So if you back down and you're not holding your guns on that, the deal will die. And so, it's not just about, if it was just about price, then why isn't the Econo Lodge filled up?
Why do people go to New York?
And I'm just saying that, yes. If it's just about price, it's not with everybody.
It's not.
So, you know, it depends on, you know, obviously there's different products, there's different markets, it just depends on what it is. And I'm not saying that we're the Waldorf Astoria, and I'm not saying that we're the highest price, because we're not. But if it happens, that it can't be something that you choke when that comes up. That should be something that you easily know in your mind. I go to this when this comes up. I go to this when this comes up. It's very mechanical for you. It's not like, oh my God, I don't know what to do. You know? Because if you do that and you choke, you lose, and the guy's gonna see, man, you have no credibility, you don't know what you're doing, man. You don't know how to close. And because you're not trained. Because you don't take your job seriously. You know? There's no reason to go read a book on an airplane if you don't know how to close your deal over here, man. You see what I'm saying? If you don't know how to close a deal, there's no reason to read a book on anything, on a plant or a tree or whatever. Learn how to close. That's gonna pay you big paychecks. You see? So invest the time to learn how to do it. If you say you're too busy, go hire a virtual maid or somebody else to do your laundry. It'll be worth it for you, I promise you. So you don't need to be messing around with that kind of stuff. Go hire someone to do it. It's not worth your time. So I'm just telling you. I haven't. I mean, the moment I decided to change, I stopped mowing the lawn 8 years ago. I stopped doing all that kind of stuff, and my income's done nothing but skyrocket. Okay, don't waste your time on stupid stuff. It's not going to pay off. You need. I mean, maybe when you start making some money, you need to outsource that immediately. I'm just telling you. Anything that it doesn't revolve you with revenue creation, don't get involved with it. That's how I look at it. But Because your mind needs to always be thinking about the, you know, how to make money, the next deal. You know, that's very, very important that you're spending your time on the right type of things. But yes, I mean, you know, this price thing, the reason why people, what I've been thinking about, why do people object to price? And I think it has something to do with, it's not really about the price. I think there's something else there.
It's not really about the price.
Well, everybody that I've talked to has had a lower interest rate. When asking about the details that the other mortgage company gave them, the mortgage company is essentially just buying down the rate. Mm-hmm. And so their cash at close is essentially higher than what we were offering at that time. And so whenever I would explain that to them, it would be easy for them to come to us.
Right. That's a great way to overcome it. Hey, let's really look at this and see where we're at. Okay. Yeah, he's giving you a 4.25, but your cash to close is $3,000 higher. Mm-hmm. You know, this is something. The other thing is that my suggestion is there's a few bullet points here on why he's objecting the price, and one of them is maybe it's not the right product. Okay, maybe it's not the right product. So what I would say, if he's objecting the price, then you need to upsell him. Is the first thing to do if somebody's objecting the price. So if he's saying, well, you know, it's this 3.5% down program is with a 3.875, right? We'll say, sir, we got a 20% down at 3.5. You want that one? We got that too. And so, I mean, then let him decide which way he wants to go. And then when you show him that option, oh no, 20% is too much. Let's do the other option then. So try and take him up a little bit and see how. That's always usually the first step, what you want to do. If somebody,
it's called the back to reality close.
So yeah, I mean, you want to try and take him up a notch. You can say, well, hey, look, you know, if 3.8 is too high, we have another option here with 3.5, but you have to get 20% down. That's how I always took the mobile homes, the houses. Yeah, I can get you in a mobile home, but it's 30% down with a 9% rate. Are you interested?
Yeah.
So, no, can't do that. Let's get the house, man. So I'm telling you, go say that to the next mobile home that calls. Watch what they do. Just watch it over 10, the next 10 mobile home inquiries. Just watch what happens when you tell them that.
30% down.
I can do it. 30% down. 9% rate.
Yeah. That's real. No, that's not bullshit. It's real.
No,
go call 21st Mortgage and go ask them for a mobile home loan.
Jane, or I talked to that woman so many times.
Who?
At 21st Mortgage.
21st Mortgage. We used to broker to them.
Yeah.
I mean, it's ridiculous, man.
I worked on a refi.
Actually, I think the rates are like 12% now. I don't know what they are now, but
it's crazy.
I'm not making that up. That's a real
9% is low.
Yeah, it's. I know you guys think I'm ridiculous, but it's really is. If you go call 21st Mortgage, that's what they want. So, but my point is that's one thing, you know, is, you know, you always want to try to, you know, to upsell them. The other thing is, if they're objecting the price, you know, the guy's probably going and running through this in his mind is, you know, is this going to solve all my problems? Right? That's a question he's probably thinking about. And if you haven't solved all his problems, he's going to object to price. You see what I'm saying? Think about this for a second. If you haven't solved his problems, then he's going to object to the price or the rate or the fees.
Will be, is that like rent versus own?
Hmm?
Like rent versus own, the vendor?
Well, whatever his issue is. What is his, okay, the guy's calling you. Why is he calling? He has a problem you need to solve.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
You see? And the thing is that if you solve the guy's problem, then it's never going to be about price. But you have to really, really think about that and understand that. And then, you know, there's other things he may say is, you know, or he may be objecting to, am I really going to use it? Am I really going to use this thing? And it may not readily apply with what we do, but it does definitely the products.
Is it fair enough to say that people buy based on their perceived value? So if you don't put, if you're trying to sell me this and you're trying to sell it to me for whatever, I don't care if it's $20. If I don't believe this thing is worth $20, I'm not going to give you $20 for it. So it's based on how well can you build the value in this based on what I need and what I desire to make me see this. as $50, so I'm getting a bargain at $20.
But the thing is, I have to know as a sales guy, is it going to solve your problem?
Right.
If you know that you're trying to film rehearsal for your church and you need a camera for this weekend and you need to be able to be up close, I got to understand that about
That's
you.
That's where the value yeah. comes in.
So,
yeah.
So, and then I got to know, okay, well, Joe, how often are you going to be doing these filmings at the church? Oh, it's just a one-time thing. Okay, man, you don't need a $700 camera. I'm going to get you a $200 camera. No, these are going to be done every single day. Dude, I got to get you the best lens. I got to get you everything you need because you're going to be doing these all the time. And then you need something that has very good speakers because it needs to connect and record. See, then there goes deeper and deeper. Now I'm going to sell more
value,
and more.
Baby.
You see? Mm-hmm. I have to know all this about the customer so I can sell him.
Put yourself in their shoes.
If I don't understand these things about him, I can't sell him. I can't close him. All I'm doing, I'm taking, that's why we ask the question. We take the information and we're taking that, and we're not manipulating him. We're just taking to give him what he wants.
Mm-hmm.
You see? But he doesn't know what he wants because buyers have such low confidence that they're uncertain about what to do. So I promise you, after you close the guy, he's fine, he's happy. And in the beginning or in the middle of it, he's shaky. Once you close him, he's happy. Yeah. Go look at all your customers you close. After close, they're done. They're done. And I'm talking about the emotional tirade, the roller coaster.
Mm-hmm.
They needed that closure. Believe me, they need that so bad, but they don't, it's hard for them to visualize it and see it. And so they think that, you know, because they don't know, and we're all like that when we buy, especially big purchases. If you haven't done big purchases before, it can be a little bit nerve-wracking, you know. And so, but once you close, oh, God, I think it's over. See, and that's what you tell them: hey, man, can we close this and get on with this? You got other stuff to focus on. You know, why are we still fighting over, you know, 0.25%? You know, so. So this is something that whenever I, you know, a lot of people I talk to when they first come in, they think, I just got to sell, so I got to sell rate, I got to sell rate. And that's how a lot of people are taught, but it's not about that. You really want to come off, as an advisor, as a client, you know, to educate them, to teach them about the process and give them, you know, that great service. And so when you do that, it should never be, you know, about the interest rate. With most people, I think there are some exceptions to that with some people, like, you know, some customers, and some people are just gonna rate shop you. But all you can do is, if you go in with this belief, like you mentioned another word, belief, and you go in with it, when you go into the pitch with the guy, you have a much higher statistical chance of closing a lot more leads versus that if you think everything's about rate. Because remember that the objections that you have inside of you
mm-hmm.
are going to come out when you're dealing with the customer, right? And if you have those inner objections, if everything, like, let me ask you this, when you buy something, is it about price to you?
It really depends on what it is.
Well, just generally, I mean, how important
is price? It needs to solve my problem.
Huh?
It needs to solve my problem, like,
okay.
what I've got going on.
But let me ask you this, when you go to the store, or you go out to eat, will you buy the most expensive thing on the menu, or do you look at the price before you buy it, or how do you
buy what I like?
Do you shop from right to left?
if the most expensive thing on the menu was something that I really like, then I'm probably going to be trying to go for that. But if it's not something I really find myself liking, probably step down the ladder until I find something I like.
Okay. I mean, so. Okay, so you'll go for something that you like regardless of price.
Pretty much.
Okay. So then that probably, when you're talking to somebody about price, you're not going to be so concerned about that because you're going to be more concerned that they're getting something they want.
Exactly.
Okay. Which is the way it should be,
yeah.
You know? And so, but just realize that whatever objections that you have inside of you, that you're going to, when the customer has those objections, you're not going to be able to know how to overcome those because you already have those inner objections. For me, it's always been, a lot of time it's been about price. And I've had to get rid of that inside of me because when somebody gave me that objection, I didn't know how to respond to it. So just think about that when you're talking to people. These are things that people run through their mind, objections, you know, whether are they going to use it? Is the company really going to take care of me? Are they going to come out with something better next year?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, just hold off. Maybe they're going to come out with something better.
Great luck.
You know, now that's how you use them on the rate lock, though. Hey, man, it's costing you. We can let's do that. I use this on, I think, your first loan you closed. When I was talking to them, I said, It may have been, or someone, one of those loans, I don't remember, I think it was yours. And I told the guy, he said he wanted to wait. Or I said, let's compare, you know, doing it now versus waiting until later, right? So we know that the average home price appreciates 5% in your area. So right now the house is 180. If you do it next year, it's gonna be 196. So you're already paying $16,000 more for the house. And if you wait till next year, if the Fed really raises rates three times, so right now you're at 3.75, by next year you'll be at 5%, so that mortgage is gonna cost another $160 a month.
Yep.
Plus you're gonna spend, you said that your rent's $1,300 a month, so let's just say you stay another 8 months, that's $11,000 you're paying extra in rent that you could have put towards your house.
That you can't get back.
Yeah, you can't get that money back. So do you wanna do it now or do you wanna do it later? Let's do it now. See, you have to be trained to know how to, see how that just comes off the top of my head because I've said it so many times. And so that you're using, you have to use emotion to sell and logic to close, always. Emotion to sell, logic to close.
That's good.
You know? So it's that you have to have that in your mind. You use the emotion to sell, logic has to close them.
Mm-hmm.
Perfect sense.
So, and you know, a lot of this stuff is just stuff that I've picked up from learning books, reading books, and training. This is not my own material that I came up with. I've read this, obviously. And so, but it's a combination of practicing and doing it. And so, and this is what, you need to be able to have this off the tip of your tongue when you're talking to people. Because if you can't tell that to someone, you might miss that sale, right? But if you're not in the right attitude, the right state, you know, being aggressive, going hungry for loans, then it's not gonna come to your brain to release this out to them. If you're thinking about where am I gonna go eat tonight, then that's not gonna come out of you when you're talking to them. So the focus, you have to be so focused on what you're trying to do, and you have to have these goals. So when you're talking to these people, you can come in and, you know, close them out, because that's what your focus, that's what your goal is. But you have to be thinking about it. And why am I talking about all this? Because it's gonna make all the difference whether you close 3 loans a month or 10 loans a month. The leads are there, the business is there, it's out there on the street for you. But if you don't have this mindset, you're not going to attract it. Like Joe was saying, you know, you're going to attract what you're thinking about, what, you know, what's in your mind. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, and we all need to work on this. And I just think that the more we going through Cardone, you going through all these things, networking, training, practicing, it's going to help us all to get better. So I'm really, you know, what I'm asking you to train for 30 minutes, an hour a day, so you can get really, really good, so you can get very lethal at this. So when these things come up, when you're dealing with a better, can I promise you, when you're dealing with a better clientele, they're a little more, they're not going to be like a layup type. You know what I mean? They're gonna need
full court press.
Yeah, you're gonna have to go a few rounds with them. You know, but once you do,
they respect you.
Yeah, those are the good ones. You want those. Mm-hmm. A lot of lenders, they stay away from those, or they don't want to deal with it because of maybe it's too hard, or they drew them down too low. But you really want those ones. So that's where the money's at. Those good loans right there, because they close easily. They have the money. They qualify and they close easily. There's no problem in underwriting with those loans.
And that guy's gonna go tell his friends too.
Yeah, it's good. And the thing is that I really. You know, our rates are very competitive, so that's not, I'm not concerned about that, but there's always going to be someone that has a lower rate. I don't care who you are, someone else, there's some other companies, that, you know, out
or
there.
Or a customer saying that they
or a lot of times, yeah, that's not even real.
Or they got a pre-approval letter that says it on it.
Yeah, a lot of times they have some offer or some little bulletin advertisement, a flyer from a builder says that's the rate they got, you know, they got approved for, and it's not.
They printed 500 of those the morning.
Yeah, no, it's true. So obviously, there's legitimate offers too. I mean, there is, and so I'm not trying to be in denial either. There are legitimate offers, but a lot of times, you're right. The borrower will make it up just to, because when you ask them to produce the offer, sometimes they can't produce it because it's not real. Sometimes they can.
Well, here's another thing. If there's a fictitious interest rate out there. Back to your reality, back to reality close,
mm-hmm.
You can either take a 3.2 that will never close or a 4.25 that we can close within 30 days. Which one would you choose? Because that phantom rate is just a rate sometimes just to get you and keep your attention. They have no intentions on getting you. that type of rate, unless, of course, they will, like Steve says, buy that rate down, and in doing so, here's your red flag. When your cost of your cash to close goes up, they probably just bought your rate down. And you have that option with us as well.
Well, I just tell
you,
call your lender right now, tell them to lock the rate, and then bring it to me.
Well, I think when you, I think I learned this today, a few days ago, with just one client. When you fight for that business sometimes, and they think they got you in a headlock, and then you say, you know what, just do what you want to do, and then they change up the story sometimes, mm-hmm. you know. Yeah. And I learned that with this young lady. She was like, well, Chase is already giving me closing docs and this and that. And if you would have told me that a month ago, I would have failed for it. But today I said, they ain't give you no closing docs. I said, you ain't even went through the underwriting process. I said, Chase has to send that to a whole nother division that's not even in the same city as them.
Yeah.
I said, you got a loan estimate.
Yeah. Yeah. And see, you know, when I would say these, the takeaway close like you're talking about, those are good. Those are usually used by more seasoned pro sales mm-hmm. like yourself, where you can take it away from them. And that, if you're new, you need to practice on that before you start telling people that, because sometimes that can backfire. But a lot of the times it does work. You know, hey, maybe now's not the best time to do this loan, guys. You know what? Maybe we should just cancel this whole thing out right now. And, you know, if you need to go to the lender, I tried it. I did that on Rosado. And they said, no, you're closing this damn thing, man.
Yeah. Gave what he wanted, then all of a sudden.
I said, look, man, we're going to transfer this sucker, man.
Same thing with Padai.
I want this hot, this is a hot potato, man. I don't want it, man. So, and then, no, you're closing, bro. I thought, what happened to your other lender? You closed in 3 days?
Yeah. But you know, we have to do this now. We went this far. Wait a minute, that's not what you said 10 minutes ago.
Yeah, so
point of no return.
Yeah, so sometimes you have to. I think a pro knows, because they know, like, the other side's. But when you hear something stupid like a 6-day close, or something stupid like that, or the guy's an idiot or what, you'll know when it's the right time to pull it out. And that's why I was like, I'm done. And I said, I know what he's going to respond to it. And that's.
Well, you saw the email I wrote. I kind of slowly painted him to a corner. I said, well, if you decide that this ain't all real, then. Call me, we'll keep going.
Man begged us to close that deal.
Yeah.
That's how we did with Shaw as well. Shaw came in making all these demands. He didn't want the rate. He didn't want to pay a point. Didn't want to pay a nothing to buy the rate down. And at the time, the rates were pretty low. And, you know, he had an 813 credit score. So he kept trying to use UAA against us. Got to a point, we went to UAA's website, and the lowest rate they had was like 3/4 of a basis point higher than what he said he could get. So we're like, okay, well, you know, you can go back to them. Matter of fact, maybe you should go to them, because you've been loyal to them. They'll be loyal to you. Well, no, we've gone too far. Yeah, I know we've gone too far, because I actually know you can't get what you've been saying.
Yeah, no, that's true.
Yeah,
it's true. You know, we've all been at a point where we're newer, we weren't familiar or experienced on how to talk to people like this. But once you get it down, you practice with it, it's going to become very second nature to you. You become more comfortable with saying that. I know right now, probably if you're new and you haven't ever dealt with these type of situations before, it's going to seem a little alien, probably, to talk to people like this. But it really does work. It's very powerful. And what I can tell you is that the highest earners are the best closers. Yeah. They know how to talk to people.
It's funny, before you even started saying anything, Jason, I was actually trying to find the words to put it together to say exactly what you were saying, but actually referencing you, because the first time I came in here and sat down next to you and listened to you, I could tell right away that you're a finesser at the ability to stress them without being stressed out, to where you're not getting them into a mood, but you're making them understand the priority of what's going on, and then at the same time setting yourself up at a higher value, kind of slowly sifting away from them as they're kind of like, wait, you're the option I want to go to, like, hold on, don't go anywhere. So, like, honestly, I'm probably going to be coming to you for a few finessing lessons.
That's good, man. That's good. So
he's going to pay me residual.
So what happens is you're going to go to him, and he's going to go to him.
So I'm just going to cut the middle out. Sorry.
Hey, go off the joke.
Hey. Can I say this?
Sure, go ahead, man.
The beauty of what I see that goes on in this office is that you don't have to know something for 20 years to talk with confidence that you know it. Yeah. And that's one thing I can say about my buddy Jason. Jason could learn something now. I mean, literally, he'll learn it right now. But you get on the, when you hear this dude on the phone, he's talking as if, yeah, you know, I've done this thing several times, ran into this situation just last week. He just got it 20 seconds ago.
I put it in my mind, man.
But
I
the thing is, if you can, and it ain't BSing. Some people think it's BSing. It's not. It's finessing. It's not BSing. So David might say it's BS.
You're telling that to Scott, man. Hey, man, this is just selling, man. No, man.
No, man. You're just lying to people.
Well, because the way I see it is this. The way I see it is a month people. From now, I would have went through it.
Right.
And so when you learn, I mean, one of the things Angelo talked about is the greatest listeners are the fastest implementers as well. You know, that's what made Michael Jordan so great. And so if I didn't.
What?
No, I said that's what made Michael Jordan so great.
What are you saying?
No, I'm not Michael Jordan. I'm
he's like LeBron. He's Michael Jordan of the mortgage industry.
I'm more like early LeBron.
Yeah. But, yeah, you are LeBron.
But you have to see yourself, especially in the beginning, you have to see yourself that you're going to deal with it. And so since I'm going to endure it, I might as well have it with the first time I see it with a history of how to overcome it. You get what I'm saying? So if I see it, I have gone through it before. If Joe has taught me that, I went through it because he just shared with me how to overcome that experience. You get what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And so therefore, I'm putting myself in that position to say, okay, I've done this before I even closed my own deal. Yeah, we closed several deals. I work for Bank of England. We have closed several deals.
Sure, you have
10,000 families.
In the year 2016, come on, man. You get what I'm saying? And so you have to use the confidence and the experiences of those before you so you can get to that point.
There's a book I would recommend. It's called The Magic of Believing. And you're going to find what he's talking about is actually in that book. You ever seen that picture where there's a cat, a kitten, looking at itself in the mirror and it saw the reflection of a lion? Mm-hmm. Have anybody seen that? Went viral on Facebook, that little picture. That comes from The Magic of Believing, where you're literally looking at yourself and you're seeing yourself in a greater measure, and you literally are speaking to yourself, looking at yourself in the eyes, right in the mirror, and you're saying certain things to yourself over and over and over and over. It sounds foolish, but if you're struggling in an area, you're not speaking that you're struggling, you're already struggling. So why are you speaking struggle? You're speaking now that you're an overcomer. You're speaking now that you got this thing down.
Right.
You know? Right. And I think, you know, what he just described is literally in that book. Mm-hmm. You know, so I think it's a must read for some of us here.
No, yeah, I mean it's a lot of stuff that we talk about, the power of all this, and I mean it's coming back down to, again, you know, what are you focusing on, your state, you know, managing your state, and the things that affect your state. I can tell you just from, and we all know this, maybe not consciously, but just going through this past Christmas break, and this indulgence, how it affected my state. And it's like, you know, and that's why I think that the foods that we, the things that we take in, you know, our physical activity, all these things affect our state. Mm-hmm. You know, if you just ate, you know, a whole bunch of food, man, you're not going to feel like you're on fire, man. Mm-hmm. You know, that's why I really encourage you guys, just eat a little bit while you're working. And just go eat a little bit and go, eat a little bit and go. Because you eat this big, huge meal, you can't move, man. You know, there's a time for that. I agree, there's a time for it. And that's, you know, whenever it is, on a weekend for you or holidays. But if you do it at work, it's going to be hard to, you know, be aggressive, I think. And, you know, physical activity is very important, too. And the more, you know, in the morning or whenever you're going to do your thing. But something to get your, you know, because the mind and body are connected. If you're not moving physically, it's going to be, I mean, we did this, who did I do that exercise with the other day? I just stopped in the middle of the day and started doing jumping jacks. Have you ever done it? Just do jumping jacks real quick. Start doing them.
Oh my God, I'm so sore,
yeah.
Really?
No, yeah, just start doing them.
I can't even walk right now.
Just do it for, just watch. I'm serious. Stand up and do them.
I'm
sore. Come on, David. Come on, man, I'm serious.
No passing gas, guys.
Come on. Come on, David. Casey. Watch how you're gonna feel in a few seconds. Okay. So now you see how you feel?
Oh, Lord.
Let's go. Come on, man. Let's go.
There you go.
Playing next.
Yeah. Is that how you feel different?
Headbutt.
The blood's flowing.
Huh?
I'll take some of what you're having.
Hey, man, it's all good. You just got it.
But you see how you just in a second, how you can change how you feel?
That's like, what did I just run into?
No, I'm serious. You see right in a second, you just change your state just like that. I mean, it's very powerful. So what you do physically, we're sitting at a desk all day.
Yeah.
Right? So your brain's going down. I mean,
right.
So you have to do something to...
Well, some of us sit at a desk all day.
Well,
some of us got to get up every couple of minutes just so we won't.
You guys don't see. I'm doing that in my office 4 or 5 times a day to keep my mind. Huh? Well, you'll notice that when your brain will start to, like, you just watch what your brain's doing. And if it starts to get negative or you get tired, just get up and start doing it. It should be a trained habit.
That's even worse.
Huh?
Then I don't want to do them.
Well, no, because you want to quickly snap out of it, you know, or... You know, so the state management is very, very important. And you know, we go long in long hours, and you know, sometimes easy something happens, and so, but it's very powerful. So as far as overcoming objections, what I wanted to just do is just a quick drill with you guys and see how you guys respond. It's just totally random. So,
Jason.
Huh?
Why are you always talking about Jason?
Why are you singing like Philip Bailey?
Jason a dream.
Why are you in your falsetto?
So Justin, I need to think about it, man. I don't know. I'm not ready to buy right now. I don't know what. I need to think about it right now. I'll get back to you after the holiday.
All right, Angela, you said you need to think about it, but let me just explain that. You know, the longer you think about it, the more it's going to cost you in the long run. The more of a chance you have of rates climbing, you know, and you paying more for your house than you need to. Also, you know, you told me you're renting at $1,200 a month, so you're kind of throwing that $1,200 away. You know, every second that you spend thinking about it, it's just costing you money that you're not going to get back.
How is it costing me more money?
Well, like I said, the rates are going to climb, so you might not even qualify. And on top of that, the rent that you're paying, you're never going to see that money back when you could be paying your mortgage and building equity in your own home.
Okay.
So let's do this now.
Come on, man. Tie it in, baby.
Okay.
You're doing too good. Just not tie it in.
So what do you guys think when somebody says, I need to think about it, how he responds to that? Because you're going to get, I need to think about it. So huge. That happens a lot. I need to think about it.
I think you need to put it back.
I just took your application. You prepared for this. Why are you going to think? You spent a long time preparing for it. I can see you're ready. Why would you're doing yourself a disservice.
I would have asked him a question. Why do you want to think about it? And what is it that you're thinking about?
Well, that's the question. Yes. Not even why, what? That's okay. You got to think about it. That's great, sir. But what is it precisely that you have
because
to think
about? Because you might be overcoming something that he ain't even thinking about.
You could have problems in your own life. You can't do it right now for some reason.
It's the same thing. Like
we're all over the place trying to give a... We don't know what the reason is.
It's like the same thing in the car dealership, right? So when
so I'm going to go ahead. I mean, I'm waiting for the Ekinson. I'm going to leave it.
The other person is sitting on the other table.
Oh,
go ahead. Well,
let's focus.
So, if you think about it, because when I used to sell cars, they always used to sit, you know, we have next to you. And he's like, you know what? I'm thinking about it. And I said, you know what? You're going to go home and you're going to think about one thing. You're going to think about either the price of the car, the monthly payment, or the down payment. Which one of these three are you going to focus more on than anything else? And then that unspoken objection kind of comes out, well, I'm really worried about that monthly payment. And that just comes out of nowhere.
Because mm-hmm.
you were just going to let them go saying, okay, you just need to think about it. So in this same situation, it's like, well, I just need to think about it. Well, great. Well, you're going to go home. You're going to talk to your wife about this. Well, what is it that you're going to talk to your wife about? Is it the interest rate? Is it the home price? Is it this?
Mm-hmm.
All right. And then they're like, you know what? Yeah, I am really worried about the price. Or I am worried about the interest rate. Well, great. While I have you on the phone, let's go ahead and let's talk about it. So we get this all squared away. So there's a lot less to think about. We'll go ahead and get you pre-approved.
Well, that's exactly what we're talking about here is you need to find the unspoken objection, right? And buyers they're uncertain. We all are when most of the time when we buy something if we're not used to it. So you have to find out what that unspoken objection is and resolve it.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to make them feel confident, right? you have to tie them down. It's very, very important that you tie them down. And but then not to put pressure, but to make them feel confident. Hey, if I do this, it's going to help elevate my life or wherever I'm going. It's going to help me accomplish what I'm trying. You know, does it solve all my problems? Mm-hmm. Because if it doesn't solve all my problems, you have to show them that it will. So that way they're not scared, because people are scared. They don't know. There's too much information. There's lack of information. They don't know. You know, am I going to use the product? Is it going to become obsolete? Is Amazon coming out with a new thing next month? What is it? You know. So you need to be able to identify all those things, and you need to find. It's usually the one, like he said, the one they haven't brought up. It's the unspoken objection.
Yeah, I mean, I think at the surface level, he did a good job. But I think, and this is something I learned from Joe, that we feed them so much information, sometimes we don't check in to see if they're getting it all.
Exactly.
And so instead of me just rambling off at the mouth, let's find out. The more questions I ask, the more answers I receive. Mm-hmm. In turn, you fill up the ammunition I need to shoot it back at you.
Because mm-hmm. maybe the phone is like $400 this year. It's the old model, but the new one's coming out in 2 months, and it's the $700, $800 model that could cost him more money. But hey, what if he still buys that one through you? Because that's the one he wants.
Right.
I think once we uncover the objection, we have to isolate it. It's mm-hmm. almost like lassoing it. Because if you don't uncover it, I mean, if you don't lasso it and isolate it by asking, okay, I understand that this is the issue, but other than that, what would stop you from doing business with me here today, Angelo? If I don't say something like that isolates that, he's always going to come up with something different.